So welcome. We have a great panel this morning. It's really a very diverse panel, and I'll introduce the speakers one at a time. First speaker is Randye Jones, and forgive me if I do a little bit of reading here. I know that Randy's from Greensboro, North Carolina, and growing up she was exposed to what is generically called Negro spirituals at her hometown church. Correct? Good. All right, she studied at the Bennett College, Florida State University, and the University of Iowa. And after that, she became a touring performer throughout the country. And she's a researcher dedicated to the history of spirituals. She's been a panelist at many other events, including one called Research, Education, Activism, and Performance, REAP, the National Conference on Spirituals, African American Art Song Alliance Conference, and the National Association of Negro Musicians Conference, and the Phenomenon of Singing International Symposium. Over the past 25 years, she's been on different library staffs, including Florida State University, the George Washington University, and Grinnell College. Randye has a new book, So You Want to Sing Spirituals, and it's scheduled for release this fall. I think when you hear Randye speak, you're gonna realize Randy's a person who chooses her words very, very carefully. And she's gonna make distinctions in types of spiritual music that you might have just simply glossed over. And she'll explain those to you. So Randye, welcome and thank you very much.
Good morning. The concert spiritual has been part of the solo vocal repertoire for barely a century. Thanks to the efforts of a handful of pioneering composers and singers, we now have an astonishingly wide range of songs that use folk spirituals as their source. This is a brief presentation of some of those early musical works told through the recordings of that era. Composer and baritone Harry Thacker Burleigh was born the year following the conclusion of the American Civil War. He heard folk spirituals in their original form as sung by his grandfather and other former slaves. By the time Burleigh published his first spiritual, Deep River, specifically for vocal concert performance in 1916, he and other composers had created other classical musical works that drew from American Negro spiritual folk songs. Their intent was to create a national music in a similar manner to their European counterparts. Burleigh published three versions of Deep River for solo voice and piano, and a third of which is the version best known and most frequently performed. Baritone Oscar Siegel was one of the numerous recitalists and recording artists who enthusiastically included Burleigh's concert spirituals in their performances. Indeed, Spiegel chose to record Deep River in 1916, plus two additional Burleigh settings in 1917. The recording session occurred on December 2nd for Columbia, and the baritone was accompanied by orchestra. The 78 recording was released 3 months later. I think we need a little more volume.
I want to grow home.
Okay. While white singers programmed and recorded Burleigh spirituals into the 1920s, African American vocalists generally were not taken seriously within the world of classical music, and they had a much more difficult time finding labels willing to record them. Tenor Roland Hayes paid Columbia to make his early recordings of Burleigh spirituals. Other black singers either recorded with African American owned labels such as Bloom Special Phonograph and Black Swan Recordings, or they immigrated to Europe where opportunities were far more plentiful. Some African American singers were able to get recording contracts performing songs harkening back to a heyday of Southern plantation life. Baritone Clarence Carroll Clark recorded a number of these songs for Columbia during the early 1900s, becoming a leading performer for the label. However, he was dissatisfied with the stereotypes portrayed in the songs and was eventually able, he was dissatisfied with the stereotypes portrayed in the songs and was eventually able to cut several recordings of spirituals, including this setting by Canadian-born composer Robert Nathaniel Dett.
All the way, I'm so
Clarence Brown was in London as accompanying pianist for Roland Hayes when he met actor Paul Robeson. Impressed with Robeson's singing ability, Brown convinced him to give a concert of spirituals in New York in 1925. The men presented the concert of songs by Burleigh, Avery Robinson, J. Rosamond Johnson, Will Marion Cook, and Brown himself. The April concert was so successful, the duo began concertizing together, forming a partnership that would last nearly four decades. In July of that year, the pair collaborated on an eight-song collection, mostly of spirituals, recorded on the Victor label. The music recorded on the 478 sold over 50,000 copies, providing an early commercial success for the duo, and material that became a standard part of their repertoire throughout their musical careers. Paul Johnson were only three of the numerous composers who wrote concert spirituals for choral forces and for singers such as contralto Marian Anderson. Anderson, who was described as the voice heard once in a century, had returned to America after a decade of honing her skills as a concert singer in Europe to give a highly successful recital in New York's Town Hall in 1935. She recorded extensively, regularly programming spirituals by Burleigh, Brown, Hayes, Dett, and Johnson, as well as compositions by Florence Price, William Lawrence, and Hamilton Forrest. Although most of her compositions were instrumental, one highlight in Price's career was Marian Anderson's performance of the composer's concert spiritual, My Soul's Been Anchored in the Lord, during Anderson's 1939 Lincoln Memorial Concert. Anderson recorded My Soul's Been Anchored in the Lord in 1937, and what we're going to hear now is that recording. To go ahead and close with this recording by Roland Hayes. By the end of the 1930s, tenor Roland Hayes had already accomplished more as a professional concert recitalist than any African American of his or earlier generations. The son of former slaves, he had found substantial acclaim in Europe before returning to the United States for several successful tours. He also supported the careers of numerous other African-American singers, including Anderson, Robeson, Dorothy Maynard, Edward Boatner, and William Warfield. In 1940, in an effort to restore his depression-depleted finances, Hayes recorded three spirituals for Columbia Masterworks. One of these, his a cappella version of Were You There?, was honored by the Library of Congress with selection to the National Recording Registry in 2013. And I just thought this was a great way to end my presentation.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh. crucified, my Lord. Were you there when they pierced him in the side? Were you there when
to me that that voice, he's almost 60 years old when that recording was made. Anyway, that's it.
Let me not stand in front of the speakers. Randye, thank you very much. And I want to start off with just a question as we have a couple minutes as we're setting up. In this progression from folk spirituals, which you mentioned at the beginning, to this classical approach to spirituals, where would you put the quartets and the college groups such as the Fisks? Where do they fit in that continuum?
Well, Fisk is where it starts as far as concert performance. And they are actually also called concert spirituals. Fisk, their first tour was in 1871. And they were the ones who introduced the notion that when they first toured, the people were really truly surprised to hear a group of young black kids performing classically directed music. They were expecting basically a floor show, blackface, minstrel singers. And that was so it was truly a surprise to them to hear that music. They inspired other groups, both choral, both in college and professionally, to create their own Jubilee Singers to tour, and also a lot of music was published.
I was going to ask about the groups that are a particular fascination of mine, and I just wanted to ask about, as you got into the 20s and 30s and you had groups like the Hall Johnson Choir and others, did they find it easier to get bookings in these kinds of concert settings than the solo artists, which came several decades after that? And also, what were the audiences like? Were they integrated audience? Were they all black audiences? How did that work?
Well, there tended, it depended. The Hall Johnson singers, they were able to take advantage of the presence of film. And thus, they got a lot of performing opportunities, singing in films, both with black companies and in white as well. You know, so they did Cabin in the Sky, if I recall correctly, but they also appeared in Lost Horizons, or they sang. I'm not sure whether they appeared or not, but I know they were the choral group that performed in that film.
They had the races.
All right, we're a little short on time, and Tim's already got the microphone. You wanted to ask a question as well, Jack, so let Tim ask, and then we'll move on to Chris.
Briefly, I'm interested in some of the second level or other performers that they inspired and who went on sometimes into the 50s and 60s and later, including Edward Boatner, who you mentioned in passing, I think.
Yes.
What do you know about him? And is he the same Edward Boatner that had a group on television, the Boatners, in the 1950s?
I've never heard reference to that in my biographical research on him. I know he was in fact, his first recording is one of the early, I think it was 1918, and it shows up in Lost Sounds, where he was recording Burleigh. But I think he ended up primarily as a composer and as a choral director. And I know he did have a group that recorded one of his cantatas. And I want to say it was, I can't remember exactly, but I can't say that he was or was not. I don't recall seeing that in his. Okay.
Okay, Jack has the last question here.
Yes, I just wonder if you think that Dvorak had some big impetus in recognizing black spirituals as America's national music, and certainly a great thing to have on the concert stage, because he called it that when he wrote the New World Symphony. He said, Negro spirituals are America's national music, just what Burleigh said, and of course he worked with Burleigh.
Right.
And then the other person was Samuel Coleridge Taylor, which people don't mention enough, wrote this fantastic selection. I'm sure you know these spirituals transcribed for concert piano.
For piano, right.
And that had a lot of cachet also in the early 20th century.
Yes, and of course Samuel Coleridge Taylor was invited to come to the United States and to perform. In fact, he and Burleigh presented together. And then, of course, Burleigh was one of the, was a guiding force as far as Dvorak and his decision that, you know, to write and say that Native American music and the spirituals were primary resources that America should draw from as far as creating its own national music.
Wonderful. Randye, thank you very much.